Doesn't that sound like a testimony?
Yes.
Yeah, let it be so. Let's turn to the same, don't flip the page, 517. My faith looks up to thee. Everybody singing. My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. Flip over to 619. Lead on, O King Eternal. Everybody say, lead on, O King Eternal. Grace hath made us strong.
That sounded so good. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Happy Sabbath. Okay, that sounds kind of... Aren't you happy to be in church this morning? I am happy. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Happy Sabbath. You see, when we come to church, we should be happy. Although all the things that happen to us throughout the week, God has filled our lives to see the Sabbath morning where we can come together and praise his holy name. So let's take those areas of our lives that didn't go too well with us this week and just be happy knowing that we are here to worship our Heavenly Father this morning. Do we have any visitors here? Do we have anyone visiting with us? Please stand. Come. Please stand. Thank you. We welcome you. This is what we do at North Lake. We are happy to have you. And when it is possible, please come again. Please somebody go around and shake our visitors' hands. Let them know we really appreciate them coming. Yes, that's what we do here at North Lake. Thank you. And please come again. And to our regular members, we welcome you. Thank you for coming and the support you give every Sabbath morning. We thank you and let us continue to serve the Lord. This morning, our scripture reading and prayer will be done by Sister Aldridge, and our remarks will be given by Brother Aldridge. So now I'll call Sister Marilyn. Would you come and read our scripture and have the prayer? Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. We're happy to be here. We have scripture taken from Matthew, the very first book in the New Testament, and it's chapter 7, and it is 7 through to 12. But first, I want to show you something. It pertains to the scripture reading for today. Now, this is not too big of a picture, but see if you can figure out what it is going to be about for our scripture reading. If you can see it, take a guess. Pardon? Knocking at the door. As my husband goes around, it says, ask your Heavenly Father for wisdom, and he will give it to you. Look for spiritual riches and you will find them. Knock on heaven's door and it will open for you. Anyone who asks will receive. Anyone who looks will find. And to anyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Now just think, what parent would give his son a rock when he asks for a piece of bread? Or what caring parent would give his child a dish of poison when he asks for food? Parents who love their children don't do that. How much more? This is the verse I think is so precious. How much more will your Heavenly Father give good things to those who ask him? Shall we bow our heads? Father, we're going to ask for that promise to be given to us today, that we ask you for individual things, and we know that you will give us the answer. And we want to find more wisdom from you, and you will make us wise. Lord, please send the Holy Spirit to us so that we may have these wishes and desires fulfilled because we are doing your will. Thank you for loving us, Lord, and showing us what love is all about. Amen.
Amen.
So think about it. Foundations for unity in the early church. A divided group, but they're meeting together, they're praying together.
This morning I have 15 minutes to cover 70 years. The neatest thing is that as I look at the clock, I can't see it. So that might be okay. 2 weeks ago, two Sabbaths ago, when I was approached about doing this program, I first said, I don't think so. You know, and then I got to thinking a little bit. It's been a long time since we've done anything in this church. Maybe we ought to do it. And, you know, the theme that they gave me was an easy one to work with. And so I said, okay. And I got in my mind to do something that has never been done before and might just be interesting. And then I got a phone call that told me that the theme had changed. So I said, okay, now what? So I had to think again a little bit. And I said, well, maybe we can come up with something, because basically the theme was God answers prayer. Any of you here ever had an answer to prayer? Yeah, you know, and for me, which one? Or, you know, what am I actually going to do? But, you know, there was one that always kind of stood out for me, maybe a little bit different than the rest. Now, Chester has helped me out on this program a little bit, and every time you see that, he didn't even see the green light and it's on. Every time you see that, we're hoping we're going to get a change of picture. All right. One thing you need to know from the very beginning, I like girls. I always have, and I probably always will. I deal with animals a lot, and when everybody asks me, what's your favorite animal, I tell them, human being, female. Just the way it is. When I was younger, in South Lancaster, Massachusetts, it was kind of neat, because I was a village kid. That meant that I didn't have to obey the rules. Village kid. You know, back in those days, the girls sat on this side, the guys sat on that side, and never should the two meet, no matter what. You didn't eat. If you were in the cafeteria, you didn't eat together. You didn't do any of these kind of things. But you know what was neat? Clinton, Massachusetts was, what, a couple miles down the road. And every Friday, the girls would walk into town. And you know, after they walked into town, you know what happened next? They had to walk back. And dear old Rus Aldridge, he had his own car. And every Friday afternoon, I would drive to Clinton and come back with a carload of girls. And if that wasn't enough, I'd go back for a second trip or a third trip. See, they couldn't do anything to me. The girls could get in trouble, but they couldn't do anything to me because I was village. None of these girls were my girlfriends. They were just girls and friends. You see, up on the picture, I started early. I am not going to change any names to protect the innocent. This happens to be Beverly, the girl next door. And Beverly was not a girlfriend, but she was a girl friend. I can't remember my parents taking me to school for first grade, but I can remember Beverly doing it. And it's funny, because something went on the internet the other day. There was a picture of a car, and it was a 1959 Ford Skyliner. That was the car that Ford made. It had a steel hard top, and if you pushed the button, the back opened up, the top lifted up, dropped back, and came in, and you had a beautiful convertible. I happen to have one of those cars. That was my car back in the time when our story is coming through. And so I made a comment on it that car, mine was black, and it had seen me through two special girlfriends. One of them thought enough to keep me. Well, I got back a little note that said, yeah, must have been the car. That was Beverly, this many years ago. So it's just somebody that we happen to know. But let's jump along and get to our story. I think it seems to begin maybe around 1955. That sounds like a good year. That's when I graduated from academy. I was 17 years old, more or less. And I was always interested in nature. And I worked at the camps. We called them junior camps back then. I worked at the camps. I started working when I was 11 years old. And by the time I was 13 or 14, I was in charge of the camps. But they could not let the parents know that they had this young squirt in here doing it. So they would always stick an older person in with me somewhere along the line. But I basically ran the program. Well, and that was when I was 14, 15, 16. Anyhow, the nature program, the part I'm telling you about now, the nature program, I had classes in the morning, classes in the afternoon. After that, I was basically done for the day. So I found out that there was something happening I didn't like. In the afternoon, they would take a couple of units of kids, either boys or girls. Never should they be together. Boys or girls, and they would take them to New Hampshire, which was not very far away, to Mount Monadnock. They would stay overnight in a tent, like the camp meeting tents, you know, the family camp meeting tents, and we could put about 10 kids in there. And then they would climb the mountain and then come back to camp. Well, I found out that the girl counselors were preparing to go to Mount Monadnock, and there was no guy going. And somehow that bothered me, that there was not going to be any fellow there. And so I said, hey, I'll come out. I'll help you out. And then in the morning, I'll get in my car and I'll fly back down. Actually, my classes didn't start till about 10 o'clock. I'll take my classes. So that's the way that it decided to go. Well, to cut to the chase, this one night, it was time for the girls. It happened to be, of course, the girls that I was helping. The girl campers, there were about 10 or a dozen of them. 10, probably 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. And they were a rowdy bunch that day. They would not calm down. So I said, let me take care of it. And I wandered over to where these girls were, and I looked them square in the eye, and I said, now listen to me. You have 10 minutes to get into that bed, tucked in, or I'm going to kiss you. Now, folks, today, you wouldn't do that. Today, you wouldn't get away with it. But I knew it would work. And those girls scrambled. I mean, 10 minutes later, I walked back, and they were all tucked in just as tight as they could be, except for one. One with kind of reddish hair, 11 years old, and she sat on the end of her bed, fully dressed, just looking at me. Now, I have to tell you, people, I'm a man of my word. And so I leaned over and I kissed her on the forehead. And that was it. The next morning, I wouldn't have known that girl from any of the rest of them. Nothing romantic going on here. Come on, 11-year-old. Any of this kind of stuff. Nothing like that. But you know what? It's kind of funny. If the Lord had whispered in my ear, Rus, this is the one I made for you. You know, it could have saved a lot of problems and a lot of work. But then again, I would have missed a lot of fun. So the years are going to kind of jump along. Chester, let's try another one if we can. I can't explain, I can't tell any of this except once in a while, I traveled with the Glee Club at the college, and once in a while, we would go to Bridgeport, Connecticut, and once in a while, I would see Marilyn. I don't know. My memory is not good enough now. I don't know why she sent this picture. I don't know what was going on, but she's about 14 there. Now, if you add almost six years, you can figure out how old I was. But anyhow, there she was. Well, that was nice. And she was a nice girl. But in the fall of 1959, she came to South Lancaster to go to the academy her junior year. And that was the same year that I had something else to do. Let's have the next one, Chester. And let's take the one right after that, too. I was teaching school in a little one-room school about 90 miles away, Rochester, New Hampshire. Those are my kids. And that's the car we were talking about behind them, too. But I don't know all that went on then, because Marilyn, I guess, had a boyfriend or two or three or four or five. I don't know how many she had. But I also had a girlfriend. I was in Rochester, New Hampshire. Got to go quick. But one day in the summer in South Lancaster, probably 1958, there's not much to do in South Lancaster, Massachusetts, if you've ever been there. But the roller skating rink at the college was something that we usually used. And this one night, one of my buddies came along, had a nice big Oldsmobile convertible, and we were going to go do some cruising. He said, let's go over to the gym and see what's going on. I said, okay. So he rolled into the gym, and I took a look around and said, okay, let's get out of here. He says, no, whoa. I said, what? He says, who's that girl? And here was this girl skating along. I had never seen her before. And you know what? On a scale of 1 to 10, she looked about 15. And I said, take me home. I got to get my skates. Came back, had my skates on. I got on the floor. Now, this is honest truth, folks. One guy came by and rolled on. He says to me, her name's Carol. Now, hey, come on. This just a squirrel skating around. I don't know if my eyes were fixed on her or what. And the next guy came along and said, she's from Kansas. Okay. So I met Carol Paul. And Paul and his wife know who this girl is. And we skated for a while. She had an appointment with another guy that night after it was all over. But about a week or so later, her friend said to me, so what did you think of Carol? I said, let's not go there. That was pretty nice. He says, why don't you write to her? I said, why would I do that? He says, just why don't you? And so I wrote to her. And over a two-year period, I got to go to Kansas. I got to go to Union. I got to go to various places to meet her, to see her. And then there was always Marilyn. And it came to the point where in 1960, I had a problem. There were two girls who really liked me and probably would have married me if I had asked, and two other girls that I really liked. And I didn't know which one. I wasn't necessarily getting ready to get married, but getting close. So, which one? I told Marilyn, even though we weren't dating, but we were friends, and I guess we were a little better than friends, but I said to her, I can't expect you to wait around for me. I don't know what I'm doing. I have got to find out what's going on. Drove to Kansas, picked up Carol, brought her back to Massachusetts. Now, you know, when you write letters, the person can be perfect. You know, you don't see them, you don't know. And when she got to Massachusetts, what do you think? She was more than perfect. Everything seemed to line up well, and it looked like, yeah, this is the way. But I kept praying, Lord, I need to know. Let something happen. I need to know. Well, this is what happened. One night, just towards the end of school, and I was expecting to drive Carol back to Kansas if I couldn't con her into staying to Massachusetts to go to school. And she said to me, I'm going home. Okay? I'm going home tonight. Oh, I'm going home by train. Oh, she had this all figured out. I said, do you mind telling me what's going on? No. Okay. Can I take you to the train station? No, Elder Esteb is going to take me. Okay. And that night, she got on the train, and she was gone. The next day, August 3, 1960, was Marilyn's 17th birthday. Let's try another one, Chester. I baked a cake, got in my car, drove to Camp Winnipeg where she was working, got out of my car, brought the cake, and said, happy birthday. I'm yours if you want me. Next picture, Chester. That's me getting ready to drive somewhere. All right, let's try another one. And let's take the next one, too. You know, I didn't think about all the rest of those boys. I didn't even consider them. I just was a foregone thing. I'm yours if you want me. I wasn't asking her to marry me, but I guess she must have wanted me. The interesting thing was, that same day, another guy drove all the way from Connecticut to see her on her birthday. And he invited her to go canoeing with him. Now, I would have understood if she had gone, but she didn't. She didn't. Can I tell you, folks, God answered that prayer in a way that I never expected. I never expected that girl to step out of my life. And now, 59 years later, I am still wondering why. But I don't wonder too much because of the gift that God has given me. All right. Chester, let's try one more, because we're jumping as fast as we can here. To make the story very short, a few years later, in 1963, Marilyn and I got married. She had 2 years of college to finish up. She moved to South Lancaster. I took the principalship of the school at Hudson, Massachusetts. Marilyn wrapped up her 2 years in 1 year. She did so well at school that Atlantic Union College hired her to teach their sixth grade in their demonstration school, and she was stepping just out of college. I can't tell you how much she contributed to our work overseas, you'd never believe. God knew what I needed. God answered my prayer, maybe differently than I thought he was going to, but he did what I asked to show me which one. And I want to tell you something. I have been blessed ever since.
Amen. The power of prayer. God is never so so far away that his children he cannot hear. God knows that he's never too busy to calm your every fear. God is waiting just to hear from you because he really cares. So greet him every morning on your knees in prayer.
You left your room this morning. Did you think to pray in the name of Christ our Savior? Did you sue for loving favor as a shield today? Oh, how praying rests the weary. Prayer will change the night to day. So when life seems dark and dreary, don't forget to pray.
When sore trials came upon you, did you think to pray?
When your soul was bowed in sorrow, of Gilead did you borrow at the gates today? Oh, how praying rests the weary. Prayer will change your night today. When life seems dark and dreary, don't forget to pray.
Don't forget to pray.
Amen. Thank you, Brother and Sister Aldridge. Thank you, Sister Cherry. Thank you, Brother Chester. Thank you, Brother Campbell. And thank you, brothers and sisters, for coming out to Sabbath School this morning. May God bless you. In your bulletin, I'm sure all of you have seen this flyer. The praise and thanksgiving service and prayer service this afternoon at 1:30 to 3 o'clock. Please come out and support this service. We had you in mind when we planned this. And great things will be happening this afternoon. Come and let's experience the blessing of the Lord. It is time now for the lesson study. There are two classes in the Betty Phillips Hall, one class beside the pastor's office, and there's another class here in the sanctuary. Have a blessed Sabbath, everyone.
I have with me a book called Maryland, My Maryland, if you want to, any of you ladies want to see the rest of the story.
Okay.
Thank you.